Hey, everybody, welcome to Stand Up, episode 88. Joining me today, the legend, Dan Savage, and Congressman Jamie Raskin. I'm Pete Dominic. It's time to stand up with me right now. Well, hello there, friends, and how are you? How are you doing? I can't hear your answers because it's a one-way conversation, but last night or yesterday's podcast was not. I heard from a whole bunch of listeners because I opened this opening segment with a whole bunch of friends, listeners, subscribers joining me in a video link. And it was great. And I love that. And I want to do it more. So sign up for a paid subscription and you can be a part of the conversation, or you can just hang out and feel like a part of the conversation. You don't have to say anything. Patreon.com/Pete Dominic. Over 500 paying subscribers, and I'm doing the show every day now. It takes a tremendous amount of work. I'm a one-man band from start to finish. But I'm really proud of what I'm doing here. I got to brag a little bit because who else is going to promote me? The value of the show is the network that I've got and my ability to have a great conversation, a smart conversation with the people in this network. I got Dan Savage on the show today. He's one of the biggest, most well-respected commentators in the country, one of the most popular podcasts in the country. He's a civil rights hero. He is a writer and a columnist and an activist and a personal hero of mine. And I couldn't get him on had it not been for what I put into my career and the power of the podcast. So I'm really excited about that. Also, Congressman Jamie Raskin got him on in an hour. Yeah, and they don't just say yes to any podcast. So thank you very much for your support. Couldn't do it without it. And thank you to people who have been editing their subscription up, paying more now. It's amazing and super inspiring. And I've heard from so many people in the past few weeks since they started to go daily how much it means to them and how important it is to have the podcast in the morning. And so all of you who have written me that, it's so important that I'm there with you as well. I wake up thinking that you're taking me with you, and as I'm putting this down and you're picking it up, I'm really excited. I'm real jazzed by the whole thing, the idea, the connection that I've got with so many of you, many of which I've become good friends with and heard from and talked to and gotten to know and who have made me a better man and person and father and husband. Some amazing people out there who are so kind and generous and thoughtful and hilarious. And I love talking to you. And if you want to talk to me, just reach out and let me know. I had a listener for the very first time on Friday reach out randomly. I'd never heard of this guy and I'd never talked to him. And he told me he's had a really rough time and that he'd actually tried to hang himself. And he said at the end of his email, "I don't know why I'm writing to you." And I quickly replied by saying, "I know why you're writing me. Give me a call if you want me to tell you." So he sent me his number, and I stupidly waited 2 days. The guy could have killed himself. But I guess I just wasn't in the right place over the weekend to make that call, but I thought about it a lot, and I finally called him on Monday. And we talked for like an hour and had a great conversation, and he's a single guy in his 40s, and I had him laughing and feeling good. And sometimes just human connection is all it takes. And that's all I have to give. I'm not a therapist. And I don't know exactly what to tell you, but I have found that through my difficult times, the connection I've had with so many people in my life, including many of you now, has been invaluable. And yeah, life-saving. So Matt, thanks for listening. It's so great to have you. I hope you're feeling better. And we're all having a hard time right now collectively. So let's keep leaning on each other and supporting each other and coming up with ideas for each other. And let's get to my guests. How about that? All right. Dan Savage, civil rights hero, in my opinion. He is an amazing, thoughtful, hilarious, brave, courageous person, period. He's got an awesome podcast. It's called Savage Lovecast. He's been doing it for years. Episode 700 now, I think, 703 or something. I was on a few weeks ago. I was psyched that he agreed to come on with me. And then coming up, Congressman Jamie Raskin is going to join me. He is one of the leaders in the Democratic Party in the House, which is, again, a testament to the power of the show. We're getting some really great guests. So thank you very much for all of your support and for listening and telling your friends. So that's coming up, Jamie Raskin. But before that, let's get to my conversation right now with one of the most important people of our generation, one of the smartest, most courageous, most thoughtful and intelligent people that we have It's Dan Savage, everybody, on Stand Up with Pete Dominic.
Very excited, so flattered, and a little nervous to be talking to the great Dan Savage. Dan, thank you very much for doing my podcast.
Oh, thank you, and thank you again for coming on mine. So now the podcast circle jerk, at least our little version of it, is complete.
Well, I thought you really needed a bump. You've only done 700.
Yeah, 700 and change, like 14 years of this. Hilariously, I was doing podcasts for a long time before I ever listened to them. I was the tech-savvy at-risk youth that the stranger convinced me to do a podcast, but I'm a very slow adopter of new technology, so I wasn't actually listening to podcasts for a long time while I was doing one, but now I'm an addict.
How much has the schedule changed over the years in terms of how many episodes a week?
Oh, just one. We do one a week. Comes out on Tuesdays, but every Tuesday. We're a weekly podcast. We've never done bonus episodes. Just one a week, but consistently. We've never missed a week.
Who do you like to listen to? Is there anybody that you never miss? Is there a podcast that you really religiously listen to? Because, you know, so many of your listeners have been so loyal to you for so long. The idea that I was a guest on your podcast impressed all of the most important people in my life, and I realized they'd all been listening for a very long time. My wife, my brother, my best friend. And so who are you that way with podcast-wise? Anyone?
Well, the very first podcast I started listening to was Slate Political Gabfest with John Dickerson and crew.
Slate, they're great.
Yeah, I really love the Political Gabfest. I listen to, you know, if I had to, like, identify my favorite, besides yours and mine, of course, there's a podcast called Collapse of Civilizations that, unlike mine, doesn't come out every week. It comes out every once in a while. Fall of Civilizations, pardon me, not Collapse. And it's just genius. It's this one guy, he will sit down and write about, you know, the collapse of the Sumerian Empire, or the, you know, the collapse of Roman Britain. And it'll be a two and a half hour episode, which usually I don't have the bandwidth for. But I just really love that podcast. Every time I see a new one, and they only come out like every few months, pop up into my feed, I'm just really ecstatic.
That's awesome. Good plug. Before we get to like the more specifics, I wanted to have somebody on to talk about sex, love, relationships in the time of pandemia. And you're obviously the top guy that a lot of people go to for that stuff. But before we get quite to that, I still want to talk to another COVID pandemic related issue, which is you were talking about it on one of your recent podcasts about the judgment of people in terms of how they cope right now. In terms of whatever you're doing, are you drinking more? Are you smoking more weed or taking other drugs? Are you watching a lot of television? Whatever you're doing, it seems that you are of the very forgiving of nature, and you know whatever it takes to get through. I share that opinion. But talk to me a little bit about the idea that you might be doing a little bit more of the things. You know, are you allowed to cheat right now?
Are you allowed to cheat?
Like, no, not a relationship. Right, I mean, sorry, that was a bad way of wrapping up that question. In terms of, you know,
I've always been the only sex and relationship person that you could go to, who, you know, as a podcast or a column, who would sometimes give people permission to cheat. I was the one guy who would tell people that, you know, sometimes cheating is the least worst option. Sometimes it's better to cheat and stay and do what you need to do to stay married and stay sane. I think that cheating is permissible under certain circumstances. But now, of course, I can't say that. Now I'm like, nope, we are all monogamous for the duration, for the time being.
I meant in terms of your diet, in terms of alcohol and drugs.
Yes. Yes. Don't cheat sexually unless you have a 6'6" penis. You can't have sex with anybody else right now. And good luck getting a condom on the end of that thing if it's 6 feet, 6 inches long. But if you need to drink a little bit more, smoke a little bit more pot, watch a little bit more porn, play some more video games, whatever you need to do to get through this, everything is self-care right now. Moderation in all things, including moderation. You don't want to emerge from this with a liver that looks like roadkill, but nobody should question the choices that you make right now under duress. We all don't have to go home and write King Lear. That's the thing that went around when the lockdowns first began to happen, that, you know, Shakespeare allegedly wrote King Lear during outbreak of the Black Death, the bubonic plague,
where he
was locked us up. Yeah, and people are like, well, if you're not writing King Lear right now, you're wasting this opportunity. Like, no.
Assholes.
No. Have an edible. Watch some TV. Watch Tiger King again. It holds up to a second view.
No way. There's no way you watched it twice. You're just saying things.
No, I did watch it twice.
All right. So let me ask you about, you know, the idea that I heard you talking about this recently in an interview, but you lived through a plague, HIV, in the 80s. And are there any lessons? How much different is this? Where are the parallels and where is this so much? How is this a lot different? What do we have to learn from what your experience?
You know, so much of the rhetoric that's sloshing around right now for those of us, I'm gay, I'm 55, came out in 1980. So I saw right before and was there for it. I'm just at the bottom edge of that gay male, like middle-aged curve where I'm one of those guys who all of his friends died one day. I'm one of those guys, right? Mm. Younger than most of the guys who have that experience. And, you know, people talking about whether they've tested positive, whether they have the antibodies, seeing Anthony Fauci on television again, everybody stressing out about getting tested, and this being a virus, is all very evocative of that moment. And the fear then was just really to a great extent in the gay male community. It was difficult to contract once we knew how it was contracted, but at first we didn't know. And right now there's still a lot of things we don't know about this virus. So in some ways this period feels like that, you know, 81, 82 into 83, when we weren't sure, we figured out it was sexually transmitted, we weren't sure exactly how. There was a point in time where people thought maybe it was poppers that gave people HIV that destroyed people's immune systems. Mm. And just the not knowing was terrifying. And in a way, you know, we didn't all have to lock down, but in a way, a lot of us shut down sexually and emotionally and withdrew and denied ourselves, you know, intimacy and romance and that, you know, that very deep human need for not just connection, but sexual connection. We were cut off from that, and that seemed terrifying. And here we are in this moment again of a new plague, which is terrifying everybody, not just us, where our simple human need for connection and touch, not even sexual touch, just any touch, is the thing that we have to fear. It was really like, it was such a head fuck, you know, to come out as gay and then to realize that, you know, this thing that you fought so hard to own and love yourself for could kill you.
Right.
And was the route for this virus took to infect you. And here we are again, like, you know, we want, you know, human contact and we are, you know, denied it and can't connect with our friends. And, you know, I ache for the people whose loved ones are dying and dying alone. Even that for, you know, a gay man my age, the stories that, you know, what I witnessed of men dying alone in hospitals because the medical staff was too afraid to get near them. Their families had abandoned them. Even in that early stage, you know, other gay men, their friends were afraid and stayed away, and people died alone in hospital rooms. I'm going to cry talking about this, like to read about these people whose parents and grandparents are dying alone without any human contact or touch. I remember what that was like. I remember that moment for us, and I ache for everyone who's going through it now.
Well, your empathy is obvious there. Is there any lesson or advice you can give people who are dealing with this similar situation that very few people have a recollection of the way that you do?
Well, I think the lesson is we came through it. Mm. The lesson is, you know, do what you need to do to stay sane and be safe and connect in ways that you can connect. That's what the gay community did in 82, 83, 84, 85, 86, 87, 88, 89. People forget also that the AIDS deaths were mounting until 1996. It didn't end in the 80s. It was continued to get worse and worse and worse until protease inhibitors and the drug cocktails came along that turned it into a chronic manageable illness. People continued to connect and we should, at this moment, connect in the ways that we can connect. You know, we talked then about safe sex. We also came together as a community physically at protests and at parties. And, you know, we danced. Right now, we can't come together in that way. There are other ways, thank God, we can come together right now via technology, the internet, video apps. We can even connect sexually that way. And the ways in which you can get together safely, you must. You know, it's maybe a little bit of the danger in telling people that they can drink as much as they want right now and use as much pot as they need to and play as much video games, watch as much porn. In a way, that can be isolating. I would encourage people, if they can, to not drink alone, to find somebody to have a cocktail with online, and to share their edibles with the people that they're living with if they're isolating with friends or family, or to find some pot buddies online that you can, you know, chat with even just through direct message. And share those experiences.
I'm so glad I don't have to share my edibles with anybody in my household. It's my jar, and no one even cares about it. It's just got a skull and crossbones on it, so the girls don't get in it.
Does that work? Oh my gosh, we had to be so careful about hiding our edibles.
Yeah, with hiding it. I've also shown it to them and said, don't take these. These are drugs, and they'll mess your head up. These are for dad. Trying to be
honest. Whose head is already messed up, and so we don't have to worry about dad's head.
Yeah, I'll be fine as long as you let me have my jar. So, but the other thing about that, you know, the HIV epidemic is there's another parallel that I've been really upset about, talking about, ranting about for years, and now it seems more acute than ever before, and certainly it was there during the HIV epidemic. And that, of course, Dan, is the conspiracy theories. We had the conspiracy theories back then as to where it came from and who it affected and all the horseshit poison about that it was God's choice to punish us all. And you've always talked about that and been a champion and been amazing at talking about that and the truth about all that. But now we have these conspiracy theories as well, that, you know, all types of conspiracy theories that we're hearing. What do you think about how they have become more pervasive, and how do you talk about them and combat them? Because you've debated people in huge platforms, and sometimes the argument is if you debate them, you're raising the level of their opinion and their craziness. How do we you're platforming them. How do we combat these conspiracy theories that are so dangerous?
We have to engage. You know, the idea that if we just, you know, refuse to dignify whatever it is being churned out by the Alex Joneses of the world with a response, that it'll go away. Well, now we have really what is kind of a carcinogen of social media. It can help, a dumb conspiracy theory really metastasize.
Yeah, lie goes so fast. The truth can never catch up with it. It's the argument as to whether social media is net bad, in my opinion. The lie goes faster than the truth.
Yeah, but everyone should watch Chernobyl, and everyone who didn't watch Chernobyl, like, the truth has a way of insisting. Reality wins in the end. And, you know, a satisfying conspiracy theory that plays to someone's prejudices or someone's ego. You know, I see the vast, you know, obscure conspiracy behind all of these news stories that nobody else sees because I am amazing. In the
That's
end,
so
the truth wins out. And reality triumphs. And the more those of us who are grounded in reality-based community and empiricism scream and yell, even at the idiots, the more we reach people who are drawn to the idiots or tempted by the idiots. But, you know, a certain amount of everybody is always an idiot. Don't do that thing where you get online and you see somebody being stupid on Twitter and despair because there's a stupid person on Twitter. There will always be stupid people on Twitter, just as there have always been stupid people everywhere. We just don't want them running the government. And come November, hopefully we can fix that.
Since you brought that up, I'll go to politics real quick. What do you say to the Democratic Socialists of America and the Bernie bros who say, I could never bring myself to vote for Joe Biden? What is your best argument to change their mind?
Besides, you know, in anger saying, grow the fuck up.
Yeah. Yeah. Besides that, all that, which I'm happy to entertain you going through, because I like that rant. I've got it myself, but
yeah. That's right. I re-fell in love with you when I saw you, delivering that rant on television.
Oh, right. Yeah. The privilege argument.
Yeah. The privileged argument. The lesser of two evils is less evil. Even now, the less rapey of two rapists is less rapey. If we believe this account of Joe Biden having sexually assaulted this woman.
By the way, is that the same? Aside from whether or not you believe her, how do we refer to that? You're the perfect person to ask. She accused him of inserting his fingers into her vagina. Is that sexual assault? Is that rape? Are those equivalent?
Okay, a guy comes up to you on the bus and puts his finger up your ass. Were you sexually assaulted?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So, you know, digital penetration, that kind of unwelcome touch, particularly invading the body, of course, is sexual assault.
No,
it
not
meets
as it,
the legal definition of rape.
It meets the
if
legal.
It, happen.
It meets if it happened right. It meets the, that sexual assault meets the legal definition of rape.
Yes.
Okay. Just wondering if those two terms can be used interchangeably like that. So anyway, yeah, the lesser of two evils here, not going off on a tangent on those accusations.
It's what we said in 2016. It's what we said in 2000 when people were idiotically voting for Nader. You're not just voting for president. It's not just an expression of your moral purity. There's never going to be a candidate that you agree with about everything. Think about the Supreme Court. Think about other federal judicial appointees. Think about who's running federal agencies. You're not just voting for Biden. It's not an endorsement of everything this person has ever done or said. It's steering. Obama used to use this metaphor about steering a ship. It's steering a ship in the direction you'd like to see it go. A ship isn't a fucking unicycle. It doesn't turn fast and can't reverse itself instantaneously. It's the direction in which we're moving, and we need to move in a better direction when it comes to things like the EPA, when it comes to things like the federal courts.
Yep.
Who do you want appointing Ruth Bader Ginsburg's replacement? Do we want a 7-2 conservative majority on the court, or an 8-1 majority, conservative majority on the Supreme Court? No, then hold your fucking nose and vote for Joe goddamn Biden. It's interesting that you don't hear a lot of Warren supporters saying they can't bring themselves to vote for Biden, or Castro supporters, or Harris supporters. There seems to be this segment of Bernie's followers where it is kind of this photo negative echo of the Trump cultists, where it's about this person and this personality, and about, you know, some tribal identity of your own. And it's fine. You know what? Then don't vote for Biden if you can't bring yourself to vote for Biden. But we need every possible vote that we can get. And I think what you say to some to people is like, look at what happened after 2000. Like, I'm old enough to remember 1980. I'm old enough to remember what happened after 2000 when some people's vanity persuaded them to vote for Nader, when people told them there was no difference between Gore and Bush. Well, we saw that there was. There's a difference, and there's a difference between Biden and Trump. And anybody who can't perceive that sitting this out or refusing to vote for Biden or leaving the presidential slot blank is a vote for Trump, you know, it doesn't motivate people to come around to your position when you say that they're an idiot, but that is idiocy.
Yeah, it is. And the only thing I would say add to that is when you talk about the photo negative of the Trump supporter and the Bernie supporter, the difference I would argue is the Trump supporter will do generally what their Lord tells them to do. It's a real cult, as opposed to Biden.
That's right.
You know, Bernie is saying, go vote for Joe Biden. He endorsed him. And I'm not sure that the Biden supporter is going to listen to Biden. I'm not sure the Bernie supporter is going to listen to Bernie say, go support Joe Biden. That's the difference.
Well, most Bernie supporters listened to Bernie and voted for Clinton.
Is that
so,
right?
Yeah, we overemphasize and highlight the idiots because they're the ones who could cost us the election and have a problem. Most Bernie supporters are going to listen to Bernie and vote for Biden. But we need to persuade everyone that we possibly can to vote for Biden. I think that, you know, if I were advising Biden, he should name, as Trump did, borrow a page from Trump. Trump put out a list of the people he was going to appoint to the Supreme Court, his short list. Biden should appoint his cabinet now. He should name the people who are going to be in his cabinet, not just the vice president, everybody.
Idea. Yeah.
So we are voting. So people who are uncomfortable voting for Biden can feel good about voting for, you know, Julian Castro as Secretary of Housing and Urban Development. They're voting for, Jay Inslee, Washington State, my governor, as new head of the EPA. That they're voting for a slate of people which will include some folks who are much more progressive than Biden is perceived to be. But, you know, fucking Bernie supporters, take your victory lap. Biden is so much further to the left than Obama was. Biden has adopted a lot of Bernie's positions, you know, not on Medicare for all, But on a public option, which, you know, is AOC's proposed compromise, we can't get Medicare for all through Congress, which we're not going to be able to do. But Bernie is so much further left because Biden did, or Biden is so much further left because Bernie did shift the Democratic Party in an enormous way. Why aren't you celebrating that, taking credit for it, supporting Biden, and laying the plan, your groundwork for the person you're going to support in 2024 or 2028? And then, you know, get your candidate through. Play the long game. That's what the R's did. And that's why they've run the country for 4 years.
Absolutely.
They played a fucking long game with, you know,
judges for sure.
Yeah. With Reagan going all the way back to what's his fuck from Arizona. Why am I blanking?
Goldwater.
Goldwater. Barry Goldwater. Going all the way back to Barry Goldwater. They played a fucking long game. They lost elections. They didn't get the nominee they wanted with Reagan in 76. They came back with Reagan in 80. Like, keep fighting, but walking off the field because you didn't get your guy at the top of the ticket, that's giving
privilege.
Up. Yeah, that's
yeah.
privilege.
I love your idea that Biden. Yeah, it's assholery as well. I love that your idea that Biden names his cabinet. It's unfortunately, as you were saying that, I'm looking online here. I shouldn't be, but Trump has apparently named some of the people he'd appoint if he's reelected. He's got Alex Jones at Treasury, Hannity at the Supreme Court, and for Secretary of Defense, listen to this, Secretary of Defense, Dan, he says he will nominate Magneto.
I could almost get behind that. Like, the X-Men has always been an extended, like, allegory
hedging.
For the gay experience.
That's how Trump gets Dan Savage on board. He just got a point. Oh, wow. Okay, so you, for your podcast, for your column, I can't imagine how many submissions of voicemails and emails and messages you get. But my question specifically is, what are kind of some of the most common themes you're hearing in, from your listeners and fans during this time of the pandemic? Because obviously there's some fascinating ones that you address that sound very specific every week on your podcast. But what are some of the common ones that you can share with me on this episode of my podcast?
A lot of people are looking for permission slips. They want an exception to the rules just for them. You know, I'm feeling sexually deprived. There's this person. And my advice is, oh, great, then shelter in place with that person. Like, you know, I've been joking since this started. Not joking, like, pick someone to be your quarantine, like your Valentine. Won't you be my quarantine? And make a temporary pact to be together while this lockdown order is in place, and then see where you go after that. But you're not going to get an exception from me to, like, travel across a city, which is crazy because I was the guy who gave people permission slips to, like, cheat. And here I am saying, like, taking this really hard line.
That's a different, completely
this.
Different situation. If you swap spit, if you swap spit, it's over. I mean, you can't do that.
And having somebody in your house, you know, I had somebody call on the show saying, you know, I'm pro-dom and a fetishist, and I have all this latex gear, including gas masks. I have friends who are fetishists who have gas masks, and they've asked me the same question. Like, if I wear the gas mask, if the other person wear it, well, the other person is touching things in your apartment and touching you and, you know, breathing on your gas mask that you're eventually going to have to take off and handle. Right. You can't, you know, unless you make the inside of your apartment temporarily look like the inside of that suburban house in E.T. There's a nice 40-year-old pop culture reference.
Plastic tube. But don't you think fetishists, who use gas masks should be unselfish during this time and submit them to healthcare workers?
Yes. Actually, my husband, who buys everything, actually bought a box of N95 masks in January. He was very prescient. And I made, I didn't make him. I talked to him and we walked down the street and gave them to a nurse we know, who lives on our block to take to the hospital she works at in Seattle, because although they would have come in handy when we got the order that we should all probably be wearing masks, a nurse needed them more than we needed.
That's funny. My wife did the same thing. And I found the order on Amazon and I was like, but they're not even going to come till May. We'll be dead by then anyway. So not, what else are you hearing? What other common themes in terms of relationships and love and sex are you hearing about during this time?
Well, distressingly, there's a lot of people who were leaving or had just left.
Oh, right.
And are now stuck.
Oh, boy. Yeah.
We've seen initial reports of domestic violence rates going way up.
Yeah, I'm
as
really
people
concerned
are confined
about
together.
Yep.
One thing I'm concerned of, which is not about domestic violence, is just about people misapprehending what works about their relationship. You know, there's a lot, there's some body research that shows that one of the predictors of a successful long-term relationship is time apart. And so people whose relationships were good and lovely and they enjoyed them and were satisfied in them suddenly have no time apart, and it's stressful. And they think, oh, I must not be in love with this person. Obviously, this relationship doesn't work. And it's no. It's like one of the things that made the relationship work has been taken from you. That will return. Don't assume just because now it's very stressful or you're at each other's throats that you shouldn't still be together when this is over. Just remind yourself that, you know, one of the secrets to your success, which was getting to leave the house every day, has been taken from you.
Amongst other secrets of your success.
Amongst other things, yeah.
Whatever
it'll be back.
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of guys who can't live without their sports and or anybody, their opera. People without their I don't feel the sports thing.
Are you a sports guy?
No. I mean, I was growing up, but I grew out of it. I don't sit and watch sports ever unless I'm high and I got YouTube like watching like highlights or something late at night. But no, I'm outside always.
You know, if they brought back the basketball uniforms from the 70s, the little satin short shorts and tight tank tops, maybe I'd watch basketball. Those are hot. Otherwise, you have no interest in watching pro sports. Yeah. I don't feel its absence. My brother Bill, who's a season ticket holder to the Cubs for 50 years and very, very into sports. I ache for him. And my husband, who's not into sports, but he's on the board of the Seattle Symphony, and is he needs live music and he needs.
I don't mean to condescend anybody that is missing the thing that they love. I'm sorry, everybody. But how are you doing? How are you coping with all of this? Are you learning a lot of new coping mechanisms? Has your life been really changed a lot, or did your routine stay somewhat similar somehow? Did you work from home a lot?
I don't work from home. I'm one of those weirdos who like sits in a cafe with a laptop. I get up every hour or two. I buy something new. I tip like crazy. And if the place fills up, I leave. I'm very conscious of not.
Doesn't everybody recognize you and bother you?
You put headphones in, you put a hoodie on, people leave you alone. And there's only like, a half a dozen places I go and write in Seattle, and people there are bored with me. They've all seen me. But it's, you know, working from home is hard. Being home all the time is hard. I'm used to running around a bit and leaving town a lot. And so is my husband. But we're in no position to complain. I still have my job. We have a big house that we couldn't afford to buy in Seattle now. But, you know, when we did, we went for it. So we're able to be together, and we're also able to be alone in this big house. And there's three of us, so we can, you know, take turns hanging out in different little configurations and feel like we have some society, too. And so we're very lucky. But being at home all the time is I'm not used to it.
Have you made any discoveries that you would suggest that others look into, whether it be interests, hobbies, new relationships? I feel like a lot of new friends during this time. I've socialized even more than I normally do. I mean, I don't really go out that much, but I talk on the phone a lot, and now I'm talking with people constantly, it would seem.
Yeah, I'm talking to people. I've reached out to people. I text message with folks. What I've been doing, you know, I'm an introvert, so in some ways this is okay for me. Even though I get out in the world a lot, I tend to like have my hoodie on and my headphones in. So I've been doing, you know, everybody's doing this. I'm baking a lot. I made my first carrot cake. I'd never made a carrot cake before. It's really
impressive.
Really, I nailed it too. It was a really good carrot cake. I'm also reading a lot, including pulling books down from shelves that I read 20 years ago and rereading them. And taking a lot of pleasure in that, and getting stoned a lot and watching TV a lot.
Me too. More than normal for sure. All right. One more thing that you're hearing from, you know, listeners of yours that maybe something exceptional, maybe it's something that you're hearing a lot that you can share with people that, so they feel, I mean, I think the most important thing right now is for all of us to know that we're not alone. And sometimes you feel very alone in your relationship situation and your sexual situation. One more that you're hearing?
You know, I'm hearing from people who are literally alone. People who haven't, you know, who live alone. I have a friend in Nashville whose fiance lives in London. And he's an extrovert and very touchy, huggy person. And he literally hasn't seen or touched another human being in 3.5 weeks, 4 weeks. And that's psychologically very hard for him. And I'm hearing a lot from folks who are in that situation. And it makes me grateful that I'm confined here with my husband, even though we're at each other's throats as often as, you know, spouses are.
Yeah.
And I'm hearing a lot from people who are similarly isolated. But a lot of those people are the people looking for permission slips and exceptions to
they're
the rules
desperate.
Just for them, because they're desperate.
Yeah.
And we need to show some sympathy. And I think that goes a long way.
There's an exception, you say now, maybe a little bit more on in terms of sexting or sending pictures and videos, that before this you'd want to be more careful because how those can be used against you. And I know that you want to.
Oh my God, it felt for years like we're gonna reach this tipping point where all of us have some dirty pictures or videos that might be out there somewhere, so we're not going to make an issue out of anyone else's because we're all, you know. We all could get caught, and I feel like this is accelerating that, because a lot of people who in the past would have been, you know, too concerned about security or privacy to rub one out on a video chat app with somebody, a lot of people are doing that. The New York City Health Department encouraged people to do that.
Yeah, it's great.
And so hopefully soon we'll be at that, you know, we at that point we arrived with pot. I mean, when you think about the arc of pot, you know, it used to be if you'd known to use pot, it could destroy your political career. And then we got to Clinton saying, you know, I've smoked, but I didn't inhale. And then we got to Obama saying, yeah, I inhaled. That was the point. I got high. That was the point. And it was suddenly a non-issue. And then, of course, we had George W. Bush in the middle there, who was probably a coke fiend, and kind of winked at it.
Right.
And now it's a non-issue. It can't hurt you politically to, you know, it's weird if you didn't smoke pot. People are like, what was wrong with you? You've never tried pot? Like,
that's a great analogy. Yeah.
And I think we're doing the same thing with dirty pictures. We just saw that Congresswoman Katie Hill.
Yep.
Maybe I'm getting her name wrong.
That's right.
You know, she was basically cashiered, you know, had to leave Congress because of the sex messages and potential relationship and violation of House rules. And, you know, we had Anthony Weiner. We've had the political careers destroyed by the dirty pictures. And now we're going to get to, you know, soon we're going to get to, you know, I took that picture, but, you know, I didn't really want it to be out there, or, you know, somebody hacked my phone. Then we're going to get to somebody like Obama saying, yeah, that's my dick pic. Vote for me.
Obama.
And it's not going to be an issue. And then it's going to be like, what? You've never taken you never sent a sex message? You have no dirty pictures circulating online? What's wrong with you?
There's some we could just riff forever right now on who's we'd want to see, who we know has one.
We're going to see the president's dick or the president's tits at some point. The odds that it'll be Trump's, I thought at the beginning of his term, were really high. But the presidential dick pic is inevitable. And we should, you know, if it was Trump, that might be good because, you know, because then in solidarity, Mitch McConnell and Sean Hannity would release theirs, too. And we just get more quickly to that point where nobody could make an issue of it.
It's funny to imagine what any of those guys' dicks look like. And you just obviously when you think of McConnell's, you think of a shell. But I also was thinking that there's, as far as I know, there is no picture of my dick. And I don't know. I've never taken one. And so now I'm not more likely to, because I'm in a relationship with my wife who I live with, unless for some reason I could send a dick pic like downstairs. I don't think
you should send it to your wife. A lot of people flirt with their established partners through sex messages, particularly when they're apart. You're a comedian on the road. You send
a picture
home to remind them what they're missing.
I send her as many kind of romantic and, yes, sexual things, but I write them. If I sent a picture of my dick to my wife, I think she would be so bored.
Oh, my gosh. Well, this is how we know that your wife and my husband are not the same person.
Thank you very much for joining me. I really appreciate it. Fun to talk to you. And, of course, I'm a huge fan. I'll keep listening to your podcast, reading your column, and look forward to talking to you again. Dan, thanks so much. And it was great to be on with you. That was a huge, huge hit for me in a really important time.
Thank you, too. And you've been doing such great content about COVID, and one of the podcasts out there helping to keep me sane and grounded and informed. And I really appreciate it.
Thank you, Dan Savage. That was fun. OMG, 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 Dan Savage. That was so cool. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I enjoyed doing it. I was a little bit nervous, but that was pretty good. Pretty happy with the way that it went, and hopefully we'll be able to get him back on the show. But right now, I want to throw to my next guest, It's Congressman. I should tell you, tomorrow I have Rich Louv, who is my favorite writer. Well, my favorite kind of nonfiction writer about nature, at least. Love Rich. He's become a mentor and a friend. He's going to join me tomorrow. And I don't know what else I've got coming up the rest of the week. I've got a few in the can, but I love doing these on the day and trying to keep as relevant as I can and get you the best experts that we can find for you. You let me know who you'd like to hear on the program, especially those people you'd like to hear weekly. I'd love to start handing out some weekly slots. Now that I'm doing this daily, it makes it easier to book. So whose voices do you want to hear? Because I bet you I can get them. Okay, Congressman Jamie Reskin is... I gave his whole intro, I think, right here at the top of it. So let me just throw to my conversation with Congressman Jamie Reskin, who you probably know if you watch the impeachment hearings. You definitely recognize him. Very smart guy. He was on the Judiciary Hearing Committee, so you saw him a lot questioning the witnesses. But we talk about reopening the government, and I give a little intro, so here it is right now. Very excited to have Congressman Jamie Raskin joining me right now. He proudly serves Maryland's 8th District, and he is on a whole bunch of really important committees in the House of Representatives, Committee on Rules, Judiciary Committee, Oversight and Reform, of course, the Committee on House Administration, which he is the vice chair for. We're talking today about the Reopen America Act, which is a piece of legislation he and a handful of others introduced and now has over 50, I think, co-sponsors. Congressman, thank you very much for joining me.
Pete, I'm delighted to be with you.
So, first of all, let me just ask you real quick, what is the Committee on House Administration, which you're the vice chair of? What does that do?
The House Administration Committee has one substantive piece of jurisdiction, which is election law. So, we're the ones that are pushing for, well, we were pushing for $4 billion, but it's unclear exactly. But we're certainly billions of dollars for mail-in balloting to be an option in every state in the union. And but the rest of what we do is oversee Congress itself and the Capitol grounds and the museums and all that kind of stuff. So if we ever get out of here and you come to Washington and you need tickets to one of the museums, you've got friends in low places, I can help you out.
I'd love to do that with my family and my kids. But just on that issue of the election, what is your main concern about the November 2020 election in terms of if we do still have this pandemic or if it comes back and mail-in balloting and how widespread that could be or how much obstruction there might be?
Well, my fear is that it will be an unsafe election. And if we can get this through, I'm hoping we call it just the Safe Voting Act. It's all about allowing people to use mail-in balloting, which is in use in many states across the union. I mean, some states like Oregon have exclusively mail-in balloting, and I think they have the highest turnout rates in the whole country, 70% or 80%. Donald Trump gave the game away when he said, oh, you know what, we can't do that. The Republicans will never win an election again.
Yeah.
I mean, so he thought of it immediately in political terms, and then he predicted quite self-destructively that, oh yeah, the more people that participate, the worse we'll do in the Republican Party. Well, that's it's a terrible way to think about it, and it's a terrible reason to put people in danger, which is basically what happened in that Wisconsin election 2 weeks ago.
Yeah. So let me ask you, of course, about the Reopen America Act of 2020, which you guys have introduced in the House. But before you explain that, what is wrong with the president's three-phase plan to reopen America that he introduced last week?
Well, I beg all of your listeners to go and look at the president's so-called plan. There's nothing in it that says anything about what the federal government will do. It's a series of voluntary, optional recommendations and guidelines for the states to think about reopening in a certain way. It has nothing to do with a plan to organize the federal government of the United States of America to get us back to work and to get us out of this nightmare. It would be as if in the middle of the Depression, FDR, instead of launching a new deal with national government leadership to spearhead an effort to recover, sent out talking points to the state saying, here are some guidelines for you to think about as you go about the recovery process. And that's basically what we just witnessed. His plan was no plan, zero plan at all. There's nothing in there. He wants to...
Congressman, get right up on that phone. I'm losing you just a little bit.
I'm sorry. Basically, the president wants to assert that he's got all the power, but he's shown no responsibility whatsoever in terms of actually setting forth a plan that'll put America back to work. Now, there's one other group of people who actually are thinking about a plan, and that's the governors. And they have formed like these little coalitions in the Northeast, in the Midwest, in California. I think most states are still not part of them, but a bunch of states are part of them. And that's promising. But of course, that's like pre-constitutional. That's like the Articles of Confederation, where the states are either at war with each other in bidding wars, trying to, you know, get the resources that they need, where every state is an enemy of every other state, and they got trade restrictions, and there's no federal government to help. What we need is a real plan where the federal government takes responsibility for producing industrially, galvanizing manufacturing to produce the PPEs that we need, the ventilators that we need, all of the healthcare equipment we need, where the federal government then puts out a process where every state can apply to reopen, and they explain how they've met two scientific criteria. One, the hospitals can meet demand in their state, and two, the trend lines are in the right direction so that the transmission rate is below one. That is, each person who's got the disease is infecting less than one person. Hopefully they're infecting nobody, but less than one, the trend lines go down. Right. If it's more than one, you get to pandemic, right? Then once you've got that, you can apply. And you tell us, what are the public health plans that you're putting in place? We give you advice. We have scientists in the HHS and CDC who can help. And then we approve your plan. And guess what? We pay for it, because that's what the federal government is for. We take responsibility rather than just saying, here's some guidelines you guys might want to think about. Now go do your own thing. It's completely irresponsible. We'll never get out of this situation if we follow what the president is doing, even if we have little coalitions of states trying to behave responsibly. We need national government leadership. That's why we've got a constitution. That's why we've got a Congress. That's why we've got a president. So we need the Republicans to join us in passing a Reopen America Act. And we're all ears in terms of what they think we should be doing. This is all going to have to be through the Secretary of HHS and through the Defense Logistics Agency. We've mapped out the whole plan, how to do it. If they want to make some amendments, great. Come and give us your best thoughts, but stop this nonsense of just careening every day to a new set of talking points, denouncing this governor or railing against the World Health Organization. That is not leadership.
So you're basing your plan on science and safety, infection rates, tracing and testing. And you're a con law professor. And maybe you could explain to me the difference of what the role should be for the federal government. We heard his son-in-law, who for some insane reason has a job in the administration, talking about these ventilators are the federal government's. They're not for the states. We've heard that kind of rhetoric. Could you tell me, because you're the expert, what is the federal government's responsibility in a pandemic like this?
Well, they think that the federal government's responsibility is basically to do nothing, to advance no plan. And then when a friendly governor who is sufficiently obsequious calls the president, they're able to send them 50 ventilators or 100 ventilators. What happened to the million ventilators that we need? What happened to the million tests that we need every single day? You know, somewhere between 25 and 50% of the people who have COVID-19 are asymptomatic. That means that there are certainly tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of people walking around right now who have COVID-19, who are contagious, who are infecting people unknowingly, unwittingly. That means we need to have mass public testing so that we're getting at least representative samples of major population bases so we know where our resources need to be deployed. But right now, it's like blind man's bluff. I mean, we're in the dark. And this administration is not giving us any scientific plan to see our way through. And we've got to get Congress back together. We got to come to Washington. We've got to find the adults in the room. And we've got to pass a plan to get us out of this nightmare.
Even if you were able to pass your plan out of the House, Reopen America Act 2020, what is the likelihood that anything would happen in the Senate?
Well, I am hoping that there are sufficient people who are not drowning in propaganda and, you know, death cult wishes, which now we're seeing broadcast every day from the capitals as the president eggs people on to go out with no masks on, not observing social distancing, and then just railing against different conspiracy theory targets. But if we can find enough Republican senators who understand literally the fate of our republic rides on this, this is not a joke. And we've got to turn off the president every night. People have got to stop indulging in the madness. And we need a plan to get out of this. We need an actual plan. We can do this. We've got the greatest scientists in the world. We've got the greatest industrial apparatus if we can mobilize it. We've done it before with war production boards. We can create a health system production board. We can approve the plans of the states and we can back them up and we can get out of this nightmare instead of dissolving into this sectarian madness. It's like these people are on the road to Jonestown.
Congressman Jamie Raskin, really appreciate your time joining me and your work on this and everything else that you've been doing in Congress. Everybody follow him right now on Twitter at Rep Raskin, and I hope to get to talk to you again soon. Thank you so much for joining me, sir. Keep up the good work and good luck.
Pleasure's all mine, Pete. Best to you.
All right. Bye. Well, that ended quickly. But hopefully today's episode did not. Thank you very much for tuning in. That's all I've got for you today. Now it's time to go do a television show in New Zealand, where apparently they have the best leader in the world. Friends of mine are television producers down there, invite me on about once a month. Looking forward to that. I'll share that appearance with you on my social media, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, LinkedIn, MySpace, Alta Vista, AOL. I'm on all of them, so check it out. And if you want to be a part of the program and sign up for one of the live episodes, then go subscribe right now. Patreon.com/Pete Dominic. I cannot do it without you. Thank you very much again to Dan Savage, Congressman Jamie Raskin. And tomorrow, I've got the great Rich Louvre. If you haven't read his stuff, go get it all right now. Talk to you then. Thanks, guys.